any delay.
Fraser is going to talk about tarpon fishing. He's obviously brought all kinds of stuff. So he's going to dazzle us. And Captain Fraser.
Thanks, guys. Thank you for welcoming me to your club. I'm actually pretty honored to be here. Eric contacted me, and I guess got in contact with me from Andy at LMR Tackle. And told me a little bit about it. And I'm fortunate enough to fish offshore and inshore. I'm a captain for a 68 Viking. I was on a 92 before that and a 65 before that. So I've been doing it for like 10 to 12 years now, at least for the sport fish. Inshore for tarpon, I've been since 1997 on and off. So quite a long time, but mostly right here in Miami and South Florida for the tarpon. But my new year started off pretty good on the sport fish, so far I've been pretty busy on that. And I've been fishing down ocean reef, that's where we're based. And it's been really good fishing. It's kind of hit or miss though. It's like one day it'll be real slow, and the next day it'll be like kind of on fire. Found a nice weed line of 500, and we've got like 5, 6, 7 dolphin, and a couple of them are up there around 20 pounds, so that was pretty good. Next day we went out on the kites, we did 4 to 5 on sailfish, and then the next day was pretty slow, but we only fished for a couple hours, but we got a 30-pound body on the kite. So that was by far, that's pretty, on a circle, just to work on.
And this is all while you're tarpon fishing?
So pretty to the point here about tarpon fishing. How did I kind of get into that? Well, as if I wasn't fishing enough, like you said, I fish at night for tarpon. When I'm not on the sport fish, I'll pack my stuff in, and then I've done a couple of double headers. It's really hard to do the sport fish during the day and then turn around and tarpon at night, but I try to do at least every other night. And no more than probably 3 or 4 nights in a week, because I kind of fish till midnight, 1 or 2 in the morning, and then get up and try and do the sport fish during the day. Because my sport fish is kind of a day job. It's a Monday through Friday, sort of like a 8 to 4 sort of operation. To kind of maintain a boat like that and the owner, keep the owner happy, you've got to be on top of it. So anyway, let's get into the tarpon fishing. How many of you guys have got your first tarpon? Probably the ones, right? The majority. So some of you guys still need, I guess your club has points, right, for tarpon on spin? How many of you are still in need of your tarpon on spin for points? Cool. That's 2 of you. That's good. Well, that's kind of where I like catching tarpon on spin outfit and artificial. Pretty much actually spin is all I use. And especially artificial, I really like that. So, why me? Well, I've been fishing for tarpon since 1997. I kind of dialed in a night gig for myself. The tarpon, they're pretty much a nocturnal species anyway. I found that they feed better in the especially at night. Early mornings you can kind of do it as well, but by 9 o'clock in Miami, the jet skis kind of take over, so it's kind of done unless you're way south on Biscayne Flats. But the night thing seems to be, I mean, if you haven't experienced a bite at like 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning off of government cup or all over, and when they're just slurping off the surface, it's absolutely the most spectacular thing you've ever heard in your life. I mean, you just know that anything you throw in the water is pretty much going to get bit, especially the artificials. It's just, we've had triples and quads, and oh man, there's nothing else like it. Totally blows me away and never gets old after all these years. That sounds kind of cliche, but man, it's still true. All right. Well, having to say why tarpon, Well, you know, as you guys know, the spectacular game fish, the variety of tactics, like I said, spin, artificial, but also the variety of habitats. And this is something that I find, you know, you can pretty much guarantee that you're going to get sailfish off the reef somewhere between, you know, 130, maybe 350 feet. A tarpon, you can go all the way into the backcountry and catch baby tarpon in the estuaries, right up in the mangroves. And then you can go offshore too, and you can find them, you know, near the beach or at least 20 or 30 feet, somewhere off the beach, and anywhere in between there. So there's a variety of habitats for them, sizes, and tactics. So I don't know, I find these fish kind of, out of all of them, it keeps me enthusiastic about it, because if you get bored of catching them another way, you can do something else. The baby tarpon as well, too, if you go online, I don't know how many of you have seen how many videos are online about baby tarpon. It's almost like a cult thing, you know? There's just so many videos. I put one online and, man, that thing went viral. It's something like 1,000 views a month or something. It's now something over 10,000. Just one baby tarpon video about spin fishing on a fly. So definitely something you can check out. I guess there's, if I having to say all that about baby tarpon.
Charter.
Okay. Beach tarpon and bridge tarpon. Say there's three categories. Probably tonight we'll cover all of them to save the time here. But certainly we'll cover probably beach tarpon and bridge tarpon. That way you guys can probably target them on spin and your artificial and get your species checked off the list for your spin gear. So let's dive into that a little bit about the beach tarpon. For beach tarpon, they're generally going to be the larger migratory fish. Right now in our area and like all over down to South Beach, the migratory fish are going to probably start trickling in here. They start coming in November all the way through to June, right? And the bigger tarpon have showed up in the north of Haulover and in that bay area inside there. In my belief, I believe these are the migratory fish, the larger ones. It's a pre-spawn fishing, a pre-spawn activity that they come in here in winter in the warmer waters of Biscayne Bay, and then they feed on the shrimp during the winter, and then they move down into the Keys to do their spawning right there in Isle of Maran or further south. And of course, as you know, most of those species of all southern Caribbean, west coast tarpon all kind of meet inside Isle of Maran. They do their thing in May, and then on the full moons they go offshore, spawn, and come back. During that time, it's just an abundance of tarpon around our beaches and migrating back and forth up and down the beach. But certainly, like during May, you can find large tarpon off the beach. These are just a couple of examples. That one on the right there was a 88 inch, so he was at a girth over 40. He was up there just north of 200 pounds. And that fish was pretty much, wasn't anything special, but it was basically on a BG like this, a Daiwa with 60 pound braid, 60 pound mono. And then at the end, I usually do like a 4 foot section of fluorocarbon for those beach tarpon. But this is the setup that I use. Couple of things about this setup is which I kind of think that is key. Is the mono, if I'm using braid, it's a 60 pound braid that has zero stretch. So what I found is that if I use like a 15 foot leader of 60 of mono, it has a little bit of a spring in it, which is going to give you the shock, like a shock absorber for when the fish jumps and stretches on the leader. And that final piece for the chafe and the abrasion along the body and the mouth, as you know, the tarpon's mouth is pretty much like 60 grit sandpaper. I use a probably like a 6 foot piece of fluorocarbon. But this is a drift setup or a slow trawl setup, depending if I was drifting a crab, I might put the bobber on there just to keep it lifted up in the middle of the water column. If I was doing a mullet or something, I would, you know, obviously disregard that and just slow bump troll the mullet down the beach.
How far from the bottom with this crab and the mullet to me?
Usually with the, I do about like 6, 7 feet, something like that. Depending on the wind, I look at how much the wind and how fast it drifted if I'm doing the crab. And how I try to get it down a little bit lower, then I might, you know, stretch it out a little bit further.
Do you use like a split shot?
Yeah, sometimes I use a split shot with the crab. So I'll put like three lines out. One will have split shot, one won't, one will have a bobber, and I'll stagger them a little bit so that obviously one with the split shot is going to be a little shorter, it's going to be a little higher, probably like 40 feet off the boat, just off the straight, off the rod tip with a split shot. And then the bobber will probably be the furthest so I can get that away from the boat and still maintain.
Where are you buying your crabs?
I get them pretty much all over, but I get them from Arky's Live Bait, mostly down there in 79th Street.
What's the place called?
Arky's Live Bait. It's generally pretty good. They usually have quite a good variety of baits to pinfish. So this rod here would probably be my mullet and crab rod, a drift rod set up here. And for sure, obviously not casting, it's a heavy, beefy stick. If I was casting, I'd probably use like a medium light or something like that, or even if I was doing shrimp or something like that.
What about this? Is that a braiding leader?
This one here is, I'll do generally 50 pounds. It's worked fine for me with a 7 or 8 hook, depending on the size of the bait. I've used an eagle claw. For me, the eagle claw has been fantastic. I don't have a problem with these hooks at all. I've tried Gamma Cats, I've tried others, owners, but this one is just, for me, man, this is it. The eagle is fantastic. And it's nothing fancy too, it's the same one I use for billfish. It's the 2004 ELU eagle claw in like a 7-0. And man, that's just in line. And it's never gone, not even on sailfish in Costa Rica or here. I mean, in tarpon, it's just never broke. So it's always been good to me. So that's what I stick with. And that's not a paid advertisement either.
You have a straight one. Salad or what kind of knot do you tie to the hook?
Generally, like right on here, I just do an improved clinch. Sometimes if I'm doing, if I'm dangling a live bait off the kite, I'll do a knot, but basically an improved clinch. That's it. Keep it real simple. I keep it, if it's dark and stuff, I don't try and get fancy. An improved clinch has never let me down either. On the braid, however, that's another thing to talk about a little bit. On the knot that I use here, how many of you guys try to do the FG or do the FG? A lot of you guys like that one. Yeah. It's a great knot. I like it. I use it. But on a moving boat at night, for me, like I'm getting a little older now, my eyesight's going bad. There's no way I would try to tie that at night. So what I do is I just do an improved all right. That's pretty much what I do. But what I do here is I'm tag end out.
The FG advantage is to bring it in through the eyes of the rod. So
yep.
You don't really need to do that on that rig.
On this rig, that's correct. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not like he's casting it.
Pretty much all my rigs though, I do the same with the casting. So whether I'm casting or not, like this, just let me move this one for example. This one here is just a surgeon's loop, okay, on the front. But what I do is I'll do a surgeon's loop just to enable myself when I'm doing that all right, I'm actually getting a double line wrapped around the up, and I come back down. So it's kind of like it's almost like an Alberto as well. They're very, very similar. An Alberto knot, a Albright, slightly different. How many of you guys are familiar with Alberto knot? And how about the Albright? Most of you will. So the Albright works fine. But what I do is, if you're doing an Albright, I'll just, I wish I didn't have a slide on this. But an all right work fine, but I use a double leg of the braid with the surgeon's loop. And then that seems to cut that motor real hard and squeeze right into it and hold just fine, and it still slides out with you guys pretty well. If I'm doing like a real light outfit like this one, then you know I'd probably do the this one is just this one actually has a small surgeon's loop in it as well. I don't know if I have any. Yeah, this one does. I guess I'm a big fan of the the double line. But yeah, there's different various ways, but that's it. Usually a Hufnagel on my braid, even through there. But like I said, the FG goes through, is pretty smooth. But an Alboto or an improved Albright works just fine. And that's what I'm using here.
So when you're using a split shot on the crab, you're not using a bobber at all on that rig. It's just a split shot with the crab on the drift.
Right. You could sometimes, like if you want to use the bobber just as an indicator, so you know where your baits are and how far spread out they are, you can still use the split shot to keep it lower in the water column. Mm-hmm. If that's what you're thinking there. But yeah, that works too. But in most cases, if I've got three lines out, I'll just put one off the rod tip with a split shot. Yeah. So, beach tarpon, how we find them. How many of you guys have the side scan on your boats? If you don't have it, man, I tell you what, that side scan is fantastic for finding tarpon. These are some of the images that I've caught. These are the tarpon. And here you can actually see some of the bait schools and the tarpon swimming through. Isn't that pretty incredible?
Yes.
I mean,
yeah.
And this is like an early generation. This is just from a Lowrance. I think I got that in 2012. And I've replaced the transducer like three times. But it's well worth it. I mean, it's like a paddle board coming off the back. But it's, you know, I put a little piece of mono on my transducer so that if I'm backing up hard on a tarpon, it doesn't fold under the boat. I just put a little eye on the transom, a 400-pound piece of mono, to the end of the transducer just to stop it, because I found that when I'm maneuvering around the tarpon, I've actually flipped it up underneath the boat. So what I'll do is generally when I'm running the beach down here and haul over to from haul over to Government Cut, I'll get into about 15 or 20 feet of water, and I'll start running. You can see here is the edge of the sandbar and a little bit of a ditch. And it seems like the tarpon always like to hang out in these areas. Once you find them, they'll be there generally like for nights in a row, as long as they don't get too disturbed, and you can pretty much count they're going to be there almost every year until you've got a few spots you can check over and over again. But I'll run the beach and I'll be looking at my side scan and down scan, especially at night, because you can't see them unless you hear them. Unless, of course, you're during the day and then you give them a wide berth. But I'm generally running with my big motor, or I'll use my trawl motor. But the side scan is like well worth the money if you guys don't have it. And I would get it, because that thing is golden. A little bit about the rods already. Jumped ahead a little bit of the line of leaders to 15 feet of drift, the drift outfit, hooks. Talk a little bit about that. Soft plastics on the beach. All right, so when I'm casting, let's talk about one of the tactics I do. Once I'm drifting, or slow trawling mullet, I'll take an outfit and I'll be throwing it off the bow and I'll be casting around. This is a Biomaster, a Shimano Biomaster 10,000. This is actually a Japanese domestic market reel. It's not available in the United States, but you can pick them up at eBay. It's super nice because it has a fast retrieve. I use it for a lot of different applications, but this one's a pretty nice one. The rod is a 7.5 foot. This one's a heavy action, mainly because of the lure I'm using on it. This is a Hobie. This is the eel in a 1.75 ounce, and it casts really well, pretty far. I use about like 7.5 foot again with 50 foot 50 pounds of fluorocarbon, and this is a 50 pound braid. But the unique thing about this is I actually, this lure here used to have a J hook on it. And I don't know how many of you guys have had tarpon throw the hook many, many times on an artificial, right? So this one I actually took a grinder to it and I cut the J hook off. It has a weight inside of it, it's 1.75 ounces. And I actually used a tie wrap to put a circle on it. I mean, just playing around with this. And I was like 1 for 30 on tarpon one night, and I got just frustrated with it. And actually, I give credit to Bouncer Smith, because he actually had been flossing them on jig heads before with live shrimp. But I guess this outfit here would be called like a coon pop sometimes, or they use them, you know, in different applications over in Punta Gorda as well, kind of, not Punta Gorda, Bogey Grand Pass, they use a slightly different kind of setup. But this is a circle hook, and it's real friendly to the tarpon. But there's a little bit of controversy over there, but Grant, about those jigs. Did you guys hear about that? About that?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
So the FWC came out with a rule that the weight has to be above the hook, whereas this one the weight is actually below. But this is still legal if it's outside of Boca Grand Pass.
How do you like to work that?
But so yeah, so this one, man, a tarpon for me, a tarpon retrieve is just slow and steady, like a steady straight cadence. You know, just no jerking, no popping, no jigging, no dropping, just straight. Cast count, you can count down 4 or 5 seconds, whatever you may think they're holding near the bottom. But the retrieve is pretty straightforward, and it just, the rod just will load up when they hit, you know, it's fantastic. but when I was 1 for 30, this is where I came up with this idea of a circle. I mean, it's kind of hard to relax when that big fish jumps on your line like that and not set the hook after all these years of setting it, you know. But man, if you just hold on and just sort of wind into the fish, the circle hook just comes tight. And man, the first time the tarpon hit it, it was a solid hookup. And since then I've been using it. You can actually, I use a tie wrap right here, but floss, you know, flossed on there works too. You can do this with jig heads as well. Just your regular standard hookup jigs with shrimp on them or any kind of rubber tail, which works so well. You can put these in front of Rapalas as well.
Are you retrieving so slow that you're trying to keep it right on the bottom, or?
No, not slow, but just a steady
somewhere
cadence.
Somewhere
in the middle of the water column. It would probably be, I think it's probably 4 or 5 feet down the middle, so if you're in like 15 feet of water, it's right about there in the middle. I think most of the tarpon are probably going to be looking up when they get it anyway, and just grab it.
They're going to be a lot of suction when they're about to get in a bait. But
yeah.
If you're jerking it, you're going to be jerking it out of the mouth. If you're going too fast, you're not going to be able to suck it.
Yeah, they're inhale feeders.
Yeah.
So certainly, I don't know if it's something to do with, some people say it's the laziness of the tarpon. They don't want to chase something that's acting erratic. Maybe the way I think of it is, it looks just like a mullet that hasn't seen a predator. And it's just swimming along, and it's just an easy target. And that mullet hasn't, you know, got any idea that a tarpon is coming right up below it. And so the tarpon just engages with it. I don't know if that's true, but that's the way I kind of think. It's just an easy meal. I find that tarpon, in my experience, it seems to be lazy to me. And we'll talk about that in the next slide about bridge tarpon and the way they feed there. But yeah, certainly that. Maybe true. All right.
I understand on the West Coast they use a lot of catfish and good predator.
Oh yeah? Yeah. I'm not familiar with it, but yeah, I'm sure. This was actually, talking about that fish, this was actually the one that broke my 1 for 30 streak on that very outfit right there. That was him right there, yeah. So we'll go on to the next one. So bridge tarpon. How many of you guys fish bridges for tarpon? There's a keys fishing on the bridges, and there's a style of that doing that kind of fishing. Here in Miami, I'll give credit to Bob LeMay. Have you guys heard Bob LeMay?
Yeah.
He's the guy who turned me on to fishing bridges the way that I'll probably explain to you here. Let's see. So this is my drawing of a bridge here, right? Okay, with something that looks like light bulbs. And we've got some traffic lanes here. The bridge apparently is transparent, so we can see the pilots. We can see the catwalks underneath here, some street lights, a little navigation of the tide gauge light here. I think you guys get the idea, tide direction coming down. A lot of guys, they fish, up current, casting back, but kind of creates an unnatural presentation because most of the bait, especially in Miami in the winter, we're talking about a shrimp run, and the shrimp don't run against the current. All the shrimp are floating and drifting past the pilings and coming down through the bridge, which brings us to these lazy tarpon that just happen to be sitting underneath the pile, underneath the bridge, next to the pilings, somewhat out of the current. Sometimes they're in like these little edges of the current, wading here or just coming under the shadow lines. And as shrimp wash out on these the shrimp runs that happen in Miami in December around the full moon, and January, February, around this time, the shrimp lift up out of the grass and float out on the full moon, outgoing tide, and they're out, get washed out to sea to complete their life cycle. The shrimp that we're seeing in the bay are probably around 2 or 3 inches long, but they'll go out to sea if prolong their life cycle and continue the life cycle and become those big shrimp that you see in the supermarkets that are probably like 5 or 6 inches long. But the ones that are in the bay here, they're usually coming out to sea grass. And this is what the tarpon here in the wintertime feeding pre-spawn down in Miami. So how do we target these tarpon? Well, it kind of goes back to like probably this outfit here with the 50 pound leader, as well as a 50 pound braid. Sometimes I'll drop down to the 30, but still using like a 50 pound leader, maybe 40, a slightly, because their bridge tarpon are gonna be a little smaller. They might be around 40, 50 pounds. But here I still like to use something that looks like a shrimp imitation. This one happens to be a Z-Man. This one is a scented shad with a 6-0 weighted hook. This is like a 3/8 weighted hook. But I found this one. These Z-Man baits are fantastic. How many of you guys have used these before? And especially in Chokoloski, talk about. Man, these things just stretch and stretch, and they
put
just
the scent on there.
Yeah. And the tarpon love these. In this size, that the silhouette just looks like something like a shrimp, and they just go after that. But this is the outfit. Probably a 7.5 foot rod. I think this one is a medium. These are all pretty new to me. I just recently got these back in 2021. To get them. So. But bridge fishing for tarpon, I think there's a couple of techniques that I've come across. How many of you guys kind of got cut off in the pilings? Yeah. And it's not easy. You're starting off in a place where you're going to, it's sure doom if the fish goes around the piling the wrong way. Especially as we position the boat. This is the way I position the boat. It's actually underneath the bridge. And I'll open my trolling motor into the current, and I'll be casting up. Just off into the edge of the shadow line here, and bring my bait back in a natural presentation with the current along these eddies. And usually when the fish takes, he's going to jump out forward towards the bay. Now hopefully you'll continue that way, but a lot of times he might come around this way, we have to move the boat around. But one of the tricks I'll tell you guys is usually when we start off, probably a lot of you guys have a super tight drag as well to help you set the hook. Loose with tarpon, you've got to get through that bony mouth. Once you set the hook, what I would do is take a few clicks off and loosen the drag, actually. Let the fish settle down. And if you loosen up enough where you can track the fish, after he's maybe made one or two jumps, and and if he looks like he's coming down, you back off the drag, you can actually just gently, almost like walk him out of the bridge. If you don't put a lot of pressure on it, he thinks the fight is kind of over. He feels something strange in his mouth, and we'll just drift down the boat. We'll just gently keep the slack on it and reel up on it, and just to follow the